How am I going to know about you, Tommy? Why, they could kill you and I'd never know. They could hurt you. How am I going to know?
Well, maybe it's like Casey says. Fella ain't got a soul of his own, just a little piece of a big soul. The one big soul that belongs to everybody. Then
what, Doc?
Then it don't matter. I'll be all around in the dark. I'll be everywhere. Wherever you can look. Wherever there's a fight so hungry people can eat, I'll be there. Wherever there's a cop beating up a guy, I'll be there. I'll be in the way guys yell when they're mad. I'll be in the way kids laugh when they're hungry and they know supper's ready. And when the people are eating the stuff they raise and living in the houses they build, I'll be there too.
I don't understand it, Doc.
Well, me neither, Ma, but just something I've been thinking about.
A third party that really develops out of a collection, a group of farmers. Farmers that organize, right? You have labor in the cities that are organizing around unions. This idea of unions, the Knights of Labor, or the AFL, which we'll talk about later a little bit. And this is an example of farmers organizing, right? Because life isn't easy for farmers. Life isn't easy for agricultural workers. If you're a small farmer, even if you own the land and you're a small farmer today, it's not an easy life, right? You're competing against a lot of big corporate farms and stuff like that. But also anybody who works in agriculture, right? It can be very demanding labor and not a lot of compensation. Does anybody know the percentage today, the percentage of agricultural workers who are immigrants, who are migrants, who were born somewhere else and come here? Does anybody know how?
95%, I'm guessing.
It was good, 70%. So this is the 1890s. There are farmers. This time period is basically the stuff we take for granted nowadays, you know, like where, well, you go to work and you punch in, and this is how much we get paid per hour, and you work for somebody else, right? You see groups like Monsanto, like big corporate farms, and, you know, the concept of, really for us, most people live in the cities, the concept of food, of agriculture, really, for most of us, unless you know, isn't really as direct as it was then. These folks are actually witnessing their world change, right? Where it had been small businesses. You know, if you got a pair of shoes, you didn't get a pair of shoes that were made in a factory somewhere by some company that was just churning out shoes, right? You went to some craftsman, some bootmaker, and you said, I need a new pair of shoes. And they say, okay, come back in 3 days. I'll have a pair of shoes for you. You know, as opposed to a factory that's making like 1,000 pairs a day, right? Same with the farmers. These farmers, you know, originally people saw it as a place where there were small farms all over, where anybody could get a piece of land, right? All these people could come here, you could get a piece of land, you could have independence. It was seen as being independent, owning your own piece of land. And a lot of these farmers are seeing that gradually slip away. They're seeing railroads, right? If they all of a sudden, they're not, do you guys know what subsistence means? To be a subsistence farmer? What does that mean? To subsist, to subsist? Subsistence farmer. You're growing stuff for yourself, basically. Most of what you're producing on a farm is for your own consumption, right? That's how things, I mean, if in the 1700s, if you don't live near a river, if you don't live near a waterway, you're not growing a crop that you're gonna sell. Like I have 1,000 acres, I'm growing corn or I'm growing cotton, I'm gonna sell all of this and make money, and that's how I'm a farmer. You were growing stuff that you were gonna live off of because you couldn't, there's no way, you couldn't get to a town to sell it, right, that easily. With railroads, that changes, right? Railroads can now you have, instead, if you were relying on just waterways, rivers, you're relying on nature. Well, there's no river in this state. There's no giant river in this state, so everyone's just sort of farms, you know. But once railroads are being built, now human beings are controlling the ability to travel very quickly across huge amounts of land. Everyone's being tied to this sort of market economy, and they're expected to produce for that market economy, right? And these small farmers now are in a situation where they have to transport their crop, and they feel like these railroad companies, these railroad corporations are charging, you know, the rates they're being charged to transport aren't fair. I mean, for one thing, they're small farmers, right? If you ever bought something in bulk, you know, if you're a large corporate, if you're a company that, like, what's called agribusiness, you have a huge amount of land, you're producing a huge amount of crops, right? There's all sorts of capital invested in it, so you're producing a lot. You know, you're gonna get a better deal from a railroad transporting it, because you're transporting so much. It's like wholesale, like Costco, right? You get the 72-gallon thing of mayonnaise, it's like better, you know, or whatever. Wholesale, you know? Has anyone ever sold pot? So these small farmers thought, well, if you only have like 50 acres, you know, you're only growing like, maybe you're cultivating 25 acres of corn. And you have this little bit of corn. And the rates the railroads were charging to transport it somewhere to sell, it was like, I'm not even making any money off of this. It's too much overhead, right? I'm not some big corporate farm where I can afford that. So what they started doing was these farmers started getting together and storing their crops in a warehouse together. They would like pull some money together, build some sort of warehouse storage place, store it all together, and they would deal with the railroads collectively, right? Now we're a group of farmers that have this much, boom, all of this stuff to transport, one rate, you charge us one rate for all of this, and it's less overhead for each one of them. They're basically unionizing, organizing as farmers. They were called the Farmers Alliance, right there.
I actually have one of these at home. Not this one, but it's right there advertising that it's almost, you know, like it's like advertising as a mom and pop store, small business, or made in the U.S., or even like stuff that says made in the USA. Like you're supposed to buy it just because it's made in the USA. Like that's kind of what the angle that they would go for on these ads, right? We're not, this is not some money, some Wall Street banker that invested in some farm stuff here. Like we're actually producing this together.
Do you guys know the Orchard Supply?
Yeah.
Hardware?
Started like in 1800.
It was 1931. It was later than this, but it was basically the same thing. It was a bunch of families that got together and started storing farming equipment and crops and stuff in a warehouse.
So these folks, and they were talking sharecroppers in the South, mostly white folks like white farmers, but also there were people in these groups that were black. Sharecroppers, stuff like that, you know? In the West and the South, mostly in the West and the South, right? Farmers, they organize these alliances, basically trying to pool their resources, organize some sort of way to store their crops as a group, get better deals from railroads, the railroad companies. They realize that they need a little more help taking on like the railroads or, you know, to make this society, they see themselves losing control of what America was supposed to be or what they thought it was supposed to be, right? This idea of a bunch of small farmers, everyone sort of, there's not super rich, there's not super poor, everyone just sort of owns their own piece of land. That world is disappearing, right? Wealth is being concentrated in the hands of a few people, there's these massive farms. So they decide, well, we need to organize a political party. We actually have to try and pass laws in order to hold on to a semblance of what we think America should be, right? That's why, So they form a group, a third party, a political party, called the People's Party. They're called the Populists. Do you know what populist? Has anyone heard that word before, populist? It was used a lot in the last election for two different people. It was used for one person running for the Democratic Party. It was used for one guy who is now our president, right? The idea of populism, of appealing to, you know, populist, the masses, right? Appealing to people. So, and these folks label themselves, right? We're the people's party. We're the party of the people, of the average person, right? So they have it's called the People's Party. They're also known as populists. In 1892, there is a presidential election, right? And they get together, every party has a convention, political party holds a convention. At their convention, did you guys know that every political party has a platform? right? You don't just nominate a person to run for president. They actually have an official party platform. Did you know that? It's pretty interesting. Because that's important, right? That's what the party stands for. If you can find some really interesting stuff in, you know. Because there's all these different interests in each political party, right? Like in the Republican Party, for example. I mean, you have very conservative, socially conservative Christians. You have people who are all about the free market and capitalism. You have, you know, all sorts of different folks that are motivated for different reasons, and so they try to get things into that platform, right? This is what a party stands for. So the Populists issued a platform. It's called the Omaha Platform because they were in Omaha. Woo-hoo. Where is Omaha? What state is Omaha in? Nebraska, the Cornhuskers, football, D1, woo, right? Do you guys know that the Sacramento Kings used to play in Omaha? Who knew that? They were the Kansas City Omaha Kings. Or the Royal Kansas City Omaha.
The thing about this platform is, it's in many ways, it's similar to a platform that's going to be, we're going to look at about in the 1960s, so 70 years after this, 75 years after this, the Black Panther Party platform, the 10-point plan for the Black Panther Party of Oakland, California, right? The interesting thing about that one, about and this, is that there are elements of the platform, which at the time are extremely radical. There's no way that's going to happen. This is way too, you're way too ambitious. There's no way the government's ever going to be able to do this. There's no way our society's ever going to be able to regulate stuff like this or whatever, you know? And then, within a couple of generations, every single, for this platform, every single one of these things is going to become actual law. It's going to be the way things are, right? There's a status quo, there's the way things are, and these folks say, we think it should be different. A, B, and C, and D, these five things, this is how it should be different. People say, you're nuts, you're crazy. And within a generation, all these things become the new standard, right? So number one, direct election of U.S. senators. Do you get to vote for... What's the Senate, right? There's the House of Representatives, there's the Senate. Do we vote for our senators? Does anyone know? Does anybody give a shit? Wasn't it a baseball team?
We did not, when the Constitution is first written, when the Constitution is first ratified,
the only people in the federal government that citizens actually voted for directly were the House of Representatives. Right, you don't vote for the Supreme Court. They didn't vote for president because the Electoral College was actually people. They would elect them, and they would choose the president. And the Senate, usually senators were chosen by a state's legislature. So you'd vote for state government officials. They would choose who would be senator, right? But they're actually saying, no, we should get direct choice over who gets to serve in the Senate, right? And that ends up happening. Within 20 years after this. Government control of currency, right? You have companies that aren't even paying people real money. They're giving them some fake piece of paper. Like, yeah, you know, the money supply was not as prevalent as it is today, right? It was hard for people to actually get cash on their hands. A lot of these sharecroppers, right? You look at that sharecropper contract that we looked at. If people don't have money, they don't have cash. That sharecropper can't just go to a store and I need a new plow. Well, get money under the mattress and we'll go buy a new plow. You didn't have any money; it wasn't readily available necessarily, so you have to borrow against it. Has anyone ever read what it says on this? This note is legal tender for all debts, public and private. Right? Have you ever seen that? Where's money?
Do you know what that means? This note. This isn't a note like, do you like Sarah? Check the S box or no?
No. Right? This note is legal tender for all. That means if you owe somebody $20, if you buy something from a store, they can't not take this, right? This is legal currency. This is legally recognized currency. This is actually a slogan of the pop. I'm not sure if it's specifically on the bill because of the populists, but they were really big on this concept. We need a greater money supply so we can get our hands on cash, right? So. A graduated income tax. What's graduated income tax? Is that an income tax that finishes high school and goes to college? Graduated? Or progressive income tax? Was there even in 1892, was there an income tax? No, there wasn't. People didn't pay, you know. Remember I said government, there were a lot of roads being maintained. The railroads are still run by corporations that, you know, the idea think about the transportation network we have today. Think about the airports, security, and regulating that, and then the freeway system, the massive amount of roads that it takes, you know. And have you noticed how a lot of roads are kind of messed up?
Yeah, that's why they passed the law where everyone
wants to tax. Yeah, because it takes money to, I mean, that stuff takes money to maintain, right? Income tax means, but there was no income tax. 70% of the government's revenue, the money the government was getting, came from alcohol, taxing alcohol. The same tax that Alexander Hamilton in the 1790s had said, let's tax booze. These farmers are making whiskey out of their corn. Let's tax that whiskey, and that's how we'll get some revenue. They're still basically living off of that same system, right? Where the majority of money is coming in from taxing alcohol. But they say, no, we should have an income tax. Why? A graduated income tax. Graduate, what does graduated mean, or progressive mean? The more money you make, you pay a little more, right? So wealthy people, if you make these folks who are corporate leaders or whatever, if you've been doing that well, you know, then you should pay into this system a little more. I don't know. Some people don't agree with that. Some people, who's ever heard of a flat tax? Flat tax. Does anyone know what that means? Flat tax. It means it's not carbonated. It's all the fizzies are gone. No, meaning like let's say a flat tax of 10%. What if you make $1 million? I make $50,000 a year. You make $1 million, but we both pay 10%. So I pay what's that? I pay $5,000 in taxes, and you pay $100,000. That's not, right? Flat. It's called a flat tax. Do you know what's the tax? What are the tax rates now? What is the highest tax rate? Theoretically, the wealthiest Americans today, what percentage of their income is paid in taxes? In theory, because a lot of times it's less because they have all sorts of loopholes. I think it went up to 38. If you make over $400,000 a year, you pay 38%. 30 years ago, it was 70%. Used to be 70%. Yeah, higher.
Isn't Apple like still paying like when they first opened the same tax rate?
That's corporate taxes. I'm not sure about that. The populists would say someone like a Donald Trump, you're a millionaire. You were born, your father made millions of dollars. You were born into, seriously, Donald Trump had like a trust set up where if he just sat on the interest and collected the interest every year, he would have been fine. Like hundreds of thousands of dollars a year in interest just coming in. You know, making more than most of us probably make in a year, just doing nothing, right? The populists would say, tax that. We need to tax that, right? Otherwise, their argument would be you run the risk of having a permanent nobility, right? You have where someone comes from a wealthy family and they're going to remain wealthy, and that's never going to change. You know, it's going to remain static. So graduated income tax. Low-cost public financing, loans, public loans. Is that real? How do you say it? Federal student loan? Federal student loans, right? Small business loan, you know, stuff like that. People got loans from the stimulus money. I mean, there's a lot of the stimulus money in the early beginning of our last president's administration went to like banks and auto. A lot of people started small businesses with that money. You know, public financing. That's collective bargaining, and then they threw in collective bargaining rights, which is unions, right? That was because they were mostly from rural areas. They said, well, they kind of threw that in to say, hey, people in the cities, you should vote for us. And the people in the cities didn't. They didn't vote for them. Right? And they also, so every single one of those is a law now, is legal. Right?
The income tax and election of U.S. senators were two amendments, the 16th and 17th. Public ownership, they wanted the government to take over the railroads. They wanted the government to take over the entire transportation system. That doesn't happen.
It does happen briefly in World War I. But, so yeah, this is the populists.